Hello, and welcome to this semester's final installment of A Communion of Subjects, Law, Environment, and Religion. My name is Alma Francis, and I'm a second-year student at Yale Law School.
And my name is Andrew Walchuk, and I'm a fourth-year joint degree student at Yale Law School and Yale Divinity School. Today, we are pleased to have with us Dr. Peter Raven, the President Emeritus of the Missouri Botanical Garden. Dr. Raven is a leading scholar and advocate in the fields of botany and ecology. And early in his academic career, he became known for pioneering the concept of coevolution, which focused on the role of co-adaptation between plants and animals in the evolutionary process. Dr. Raven was first appointed director of the Missouri Botanical Garden in 1971 and remained there until his retirement in 2010. During his tenure and through his leadership, the garden became a world-class center for botanical research, conservation, education, and horticulture display. Time magazine has named him a hero of the planet, and in 2000, President Clinton awarded him the National Medal of Science, the highest award for scientific accomplishment in the country. Dr. Raven is also active internationally in science policy, and particularly conservation, where he has emphasized the need for a transition to global sustainability. He served for 12 years as Home Secretary of the National Academy of Sciences, and as a member of the Academies of Science in Argentina, Brazil, China, Denmark, India, Italy, a number of other countries, and the Pontifical Academy of the Sciences. Dr. Raven, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here. You forgot that I have an honorary degree from Yale. Most important of all.
Most important of all, Eli. You've written that the loss of biodiversity is likely to be the crime for which our descendants will be least likely to forgive us. I wanted to start by getting your perspective on what is the value of biodiversity.
We evolved into biodiversity. Our life on Earth started about nearly 4 billion years ago, as far as we can tell, and life came up on land about 600 million years ago. We have I estimate we have about 12 million species of life on land other than bacteria, where recent estimates have even said there might be as many as a trillion kinds of bacteria in the world, which is totally unthinkable. Now, everything about our life depends entirely on other living forms into whose company we evolved. Individually, for example, plants supply all of our food, directly or indirectly. For two-thirds of the people in the world, plants supply their medicines. That includes India, China, lots of Latin America, for example. And even for those of us who use prescriptions, about half of them are originally from living organisms or modeled after molecules that were discovered in living organisms. And then you go on to things like clothing, construction materials, wood, other chemicals. And then, thinking about organisms in the aggregate, communities of organisms are what, over all those years that I've talked about, made our atmosphere what it is, raised the level of oxygen to 20%, to which we're adapted, control the runoff of water from our hillsides, make it run off in a moderate way, purify that water, absorb pollution from us or from any other source, preserve and set the characteristics of the topsoil. And finally, of course, we have what you might call the spiritual and aesthetic value of organisms, which is how much better everybody feels if they're in a room where there's a plant, how good everybody feels in the fields, how good it makes people to see first birds returning of migratory species in the spring. Our lives not only could not exist, but they would be very poor if we didn't have living organisms here on Earth with us. Now, if we estimate how long species normally last, and to do this you have to look at the fossil record, and you have to look at species that have hard body parts, and those would be vertebrates, or things like mollusks, like clams or mussels and so forth, through the fossil record, say, since the last big extinction. The last big extinction period, as you may know, was when the dinosaurs were finished off. It's a little dramatic because there were relatively few of them around then, but they were finished off about 65 million years ago at the end of the Cretaceous period. and then mammals and birds and other groups that were present but not as dominant as they are now came into the ascendancy, and lines of evolution of flowering plants came into the ascendancy, and flowering plants began to dominate. Well, they began a little earlier, but they were dominating the world's forests. Flowering plants are no more than we can only say with certainty that they're no more than about 120 million years old. And incidentally, world expert on that question is Peter Crane, the immediately prior director of the forestry school. So if you look at the teeth of vertebrates or the shells of mollusks, you can say how long species last, something like 2 million years. And then you can say how many there are. And then you can say how many species are likely to become extinct per million per year. Lots of groups of organisms, and I'll get to this in more detail in a minute, we don't know how many species there are. We just haven't done that much work on them. And for mites, for nematodes, little worm-like animals, small wasps, for small flies, we don't really know. For fungi especially, we don't know. So when you look at those well-known groups and you estimate the rate of extinction, and then you compare it with the rate that you can observe is going on now, starting especially with the introduction of printed records about 500 years ago and distribution of books rather than just single copy manuscripts or few copy manuscripts, you can estimate, and also looking at damage that's being done to the earth, you can estimate that about 1,000 times the background rate is becoming extinct now. And projecting that as sort of a notional baseline into groups that are not well known, that's a big loss. If you look at it from the other side of view, from the conservation point of view, the IUCN, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, estimates that about 20% of the species of the groups that they've studied are in immediate danger of extinction by being in small populations or by being in places that are changing very rapidly. If you add into that the effects of global climate change. The last report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change estimated that extinction due to climate change alone could be as high as 20% to 40% by the end of the century. If you put that all together, it looks quite possible that half or more of all the species of organisms on Earth could be gone by the end of the century, which after all is a mere 86 years from now. I mean, it'll be so when my little grandchildren are my age, they will have seen that kind of a rate of extinction. Now, if you figure that, if you go back and think of what we use these organisms for, there are about 450,000 kinds of plants. We get 90% of our food from just over 100 kinds of plants. We get 60% of our food directly or indirectly from rice, wheat, and corn. And if you think of the fact that thousands of kinds of plants have been used for food by various people at various times and may be much better suited to growing in conditions in which the climate has changed drastically than the crops that we have now, we've only classified a very small number of the species of organisms on Earth, about 2 million, and we think there are about 12 million other than bacteria, and even in groups that are well known like plants and vertebrate animals, it tends to be the fact that we know any degree of detail about only a very few of them. So probably 450,000 kinds of plants, there are only about a couple of tens of thousands that we know in any detail. Most of them are too rare or not immediately economically important or something. So we never really looked at them to see what their chemicals are like, to see what their genetic processes are like, or anything else. And those are what we're losing. And unfortunately, you tend to lose the rarer ones first, and the rarer ones tend to be the ones you've never seen and so forth. So with our inability, we may give names to about 20,000 kinds of organisms a year, 10 to 20,000 depending. So we'll never get to the end of the game before they're all gone. And furthermore, just putting a name on them tells you next to nothing. I often say, if they've been named, it might mean that if you find one in the Amazon, you could go and find another one in the bottom of a bottle of formalin on the shelves in the British Museum. But there it would be, sort of croaked and crunched over, collected near Manaus in 1870 or something. And you really wouldn't learn anything, even though you can put a name on it. So our knowledge of the biological diversity that we're losing is negligible, really, overall negligible. It's been a very short time that we've tried to learn much about it. And the fact that we're losing half of it in this century is indeed, as Ed Wilson has said, the sin for which our descendants will be least likely to forgive us, simply because it will limit human possibilities, human joy, human enjoyment, human habitats, so severely compared to what it is now. Global warming seems more immediate, and so people say, well, global warming is happening, and most people believe that global warming has got to be stopped, global climate change has got to be stopped. The disappearance of species of organisms, even though our lives depend on them wholly and completely, and our potential for sustainable existence in the future depends on them wholly and completely, their disappearance is not evident to most of us, although it may be if rampant nationalism causes people to walk away from global climate change goals or something. And given that, you can see exactly what Ed meant.
Mm-hmm. And it seems that the way that this is tied to human life and kind of the utility of biodiversity for humanity seems to be a kind of powerful advocacy tool. But at the same time, I think that a lot of the kind of ecological crisis we face now, one thing that people will point out is that it's kind of a prioritizing of human life and human utility and human benefit over sort of inherent value of nature. So I'm wondering if you think that this emphasis in sort of advocacy around biodiversity on utility to humans could potentially kind of obscure or impair the emergence of a narrative that actually emphasizes the inherent value of natural life.
Well, first I'll say that my father used to have a cartoon on the wall of his office that showed two men rushing out of a building with briefcases. And one is saying to the other, I'm working so hard I'm killing myself, but I'm earning so much that I can afford it. In other words, of course, if you want to make a lot of money fast, then anything you do is swell. And cigarette manufacturers to oil companies to coal companies, you know, are practicing that. We have to make the switch. It's not only that organisms individually are of value to people, it's that organisms, the living world, is literally the context within which we live. We have no other context within which we can exist. It's not as if you could just get rid of them all and then we could just be there in a clean basketball court doing whatever we wanted. It's that we are them, we are one of them, we depend entirely on them, and just in terms of our existence. And remember, too, that the whole, I mean, if you want to get into aesthetics or religion or something, the whole structure of our lives is formed around images of animals. You know, people are intuitively scared of snakes and spiders, and for good reason, animals and plants. People are fulfilled by them. They know how to operate only in that context. And without a context, we're nothing. And of course, that's why we get so many injunctions in the world's major religions to protect life, to cultivate the earth, serve it, and protect it. And the fact of the matter is, we're doing a very poor job of that right now because we're not wise enough to understand what we're doing. But that doesn't make it any better. That's a little bit like, you know, earning so much money you can afford to kill yourself.
Mm-hmm. I want to return to a point you were making earlier about the kind of the value of the knowledge that we're getting about species and the idea that, you know, just getting a name of a certain species that we discover isn't necessarily enough and doesn't really inform us about that species. Can you talk a little bit more about sort of what the alternative sorts of forms of knowledge would be that you would seek?
Well, since so many species are likely certain to become extinct so rapidly, you would have to come to the conclusion that we should concentrate to some extent on the groups of organisms that are environmentally most important or that are economically most important. For example, you don't have to be very sharp to know that it's important to know about trees and how to manage them. You don't have to be very sharp to know that it's important to know about pasture grasses and how to manage them. And for certain groups of plants, say the family of plants that strychnine and many valuable products come from, many valuable chemicals come from, that you'd want to keep them around. So you could investigate them harder. The other way to approach the problem is to investigate all of the kinds of organisms that occur together at particular selected places. It's hard to muster up enough energy to do that, particularly since we prefer to turn a blind eye, as evidenced by our deeds, on the whole problem. But if we would focus on certain places and there try to find out all the fungi, all the nematodes, all the mites, all the fungi that were growing on the roots of the plants and all the interactions between them, then we would learn something valuable about the structure of life on Earth and also then how to rebuild communities of organisms, which we're going to need to do to protect soils and to keep weather patterns going as they are and all the rest. So I think certain strategies are definitely called for. I don't agree. Ed Wilson, who's a famous biologist at some school north of here, Ed Wilson and I sort of have a different opinion on that. He always stresses it'd be really good to catalog all kinds of life on Earth. But I'm so dissatisfied with the efficacy of the current catalog that I see it more as an intelligent sampling exercise is what we really ought to undertake in the time when species are becoming extinct so rapidly. But plants, I would point out that some groups of organisms are an exception. Plants can be preserved by growing populations of them, genetically diverse populations of them, in botanical gardens or in other places. Plants can be preserved by getting seeds, genetically diverse samples of seeds with a number of different parents in what are called seed banks at low temperatures. And as people experiment with that, they learn how to do it better and better. And even those plants that don't produce seeds can be preserved at tissue culture. So for plants, we could preserve a great deal of the biodiversity while they're still around. Whereas for mammals or something, you know, that's not so possible. And of course, for groups of insects, which have 90% of the species not even understood to be there, we have very little chance of saving a very major sample.
Mm-hmm. And what is the role that, you know, a lot of us in here are law students, are divinity students. We don't really have sort of advanced scientific knowledge. I mean, if I walk into the forest, I can't really tell you the difference between 20 different leaves that I see. So what is the role that kind of lay people can take in this sort of in the effort of cataloging knowledge? And
I'll take a little time and study harder. We're really talking in the broadest sense not about preserving as many species as possible, but about preserving the sustainability of the Earth. The sustainability of the Earth can never be protected in a system in which we all selfishly compete with one another, in which nations compete with one another, in which nationalism rides high, because then everyone will be using more than actually exists. And at that point, you can see by the website of the Global Footprint Network, you can see that as a world, we're using 164% estimated of what's there, and individual countries like the United States about 1.9 times what's possible inside the United States, China about 2.5 times, Switzerland about 9 times, and that in turn, in a world that's already overusing its sustainable productivity leaves the other people out of luck. So what we need to do in the broadest sense is cultivate, and there's several kinds of different ways of approaching it, but we must cultivate international understanding propelled by charity, love, caring for other people. We must begin in our own families, in our own homes. I mean, how much do people care about the poor people in New Haven, the needy people here in your hometown? But we've got to extend that in principle all over the world in order for there to be any hope, because we have a natural kind of selfishness which is inbred over years of evolution when selfishness was the only way to continue to exist. If we can cultivate that kind of atmosphere where people are really willing to cooperate on an international basis and willing to understand that the needs of other people are really there, then we can begin to take seriously facts like 8 people in the world have as much wealth as the 3.6 billion poorest people in the world, and realize that, as Adlai Stevenson said years ago in his famous Spaceship Earth speech, a world so deeply divided between rich and poor, healthy and sick, cannot sustainably exist. Now, some of the things that we'd need to do to build a sustainable world would be to set a worldwide level for how many people there ought to be in the world. I mean, it's fine to say everybody has all these rights and it's swell and shouldn't be limited. On the other hand, the world obviously cannot accommodate an infinite number of people. My attention was caught when I was on the faculty at Stanford in the mid-1960s when a magazine called The New Scientist had an article by a physicist showing that if the levels of human population growth that were going on at that time would continue, you'd soon reach a situation where the mass of bodies was speeding away from the surface of Earth with the speed of light. You know, you can go on talking about there shouldn't be any limits, but there are obvious limits. Mm-hmm. We have 7.4 billion people on Earth now, more than have ever been here before. We're scheduled to add 2.5 billion in the next 34 years by mid-century, and another couple of 3 billion after that in the second half of the century. We're adding 250,000 babies a day. In sub-Saharan Africa, the present 900 million people are projected to grow to 2.2 billion by mid-century, 34 years from now, and to 4 billion people in sub-Saharan Africa by the end of the century. Well, you know what? It doesn't matter what you think. It doesn't work. It's a little bit, again, like saying, I'm earning so much I can afford it. We can't ignore all of this because we're not sailing around on little islands near the surface of the Earth. We are part of the living fabric of the Earth, and we have to act responsibly as part of the living fabric of the Earth. And to me, religion, ethical systems, moral systems, philosophical systems that take that into account will be very important in helping us to reach that. I should also say that the empowerment of women is a very important element in ever reaching a leveled population. Very many, tragically many women in the world are treated in such a way that they can't really, in effect, make choices about the number of children that they might wish to have. Children are largely unempowered in a lot of the world, and they need to be empowered. We need to build them up, and then we need to think about the fairness of the fantastically unequal levels of consumption that we're practicing throughout the world and that we've been practicing, you know, for a very long period of time, certainly since the Industrial Revolution kicked into high gear in about 1760 in England. And when we do those things, we can think about our consumption reasonably. We can have whatever number of people we think we can enjoy and live with and play with nice and have a civilization with. And of course, we bring into play new kinds of technology which have the potential of lessening our effect on the Earth. Then we can have the hope of building a sustainable planet on which people can live the kind of lives that we ideally think we want to live, but which are so difficult for such a high proportion of the people on Earth and destined to become much more difficult in the future. The last thing the world needs now is runaway nationalism and isolationism. That's like a perfect recipe for it, for an impossible future for your grandchildren. Mm. Now, I think what I've said there indicates a lot of things that lawyers can do. Be responsible citizens, speak out on these things, learn about ecological principles, learn about things that are destroying the earth and try to do something about them. Try to promote the solutions politically, try to promote social justice politically. Don't take away women's services in other countries because they have abortions which are legal here. I mean, we're just saying you can't do what we do. And I'm not saying abortions are good. I'm saying it's just an example of being kind of blind. The United States has no interest whatever in rapid growth of population in other countries, quite the opposite. And yet we're the stingiest per capita of all industrialized countries in our foreign development assistance. Why is that? Y'all lawyers, speak up.
Just a few small challenges for us to take on.
Well, you have a lot of spare time.
I think Alma has a question.
Yeah, I do want to follow up on that. Why is that? Why do you think that the U.S. is so stingy in foreign aid?
Selfish. I think we all are looking at what we can do in the country, and we always say, when we fix up what's here, whatever that means, which we also are not doing, but when we fix up what's here, then we'll go on, we can go on to other things. The United States has always been a kind of do-it-yourself internal country, a beautiful example of the kind of melting pot and potentially, or in principle, of the kind of interracial understanding that we absolutely need for the sustainable survival of the planet. But on the other hand, I think we tend more than usual to think of our own welfare, our own individual communities, our own lives more than some other countries. If you live in a country like Norway or Belgium or the Netherlands or even like England or France, which have this long colonial history and all, they know more about the world. There's more global news near the front of their newspapers. And of course, the United States is brought into the rest of the world, but our intrusions in the rest of the world for the last 40 or 50 years have been pretty tragic. Since we got into doing international warfare and international control sort of in World War I, we haven't really been very good at it. And if we say we're not going to invade a lot of other countries or not participate in a lot of other wars around the world, we tend also to throw away our responsibility to people around the world. Mm. Our responsibility to people around the world is not to bomb them into submission. Our responsibility to people around the world is to cherish them, love them, help them to build better lives, and thus build a better world in which we, their children, and their children can all live in the future.
Where do you think that responsibility comes from?
The responsibility, first of all, I think it comes from first principles. It's natural to know that we have to care for other people. Mm-hmm. Some of the earliest principles we have are do unto, like the golden rule, do unto others as we would do unto ourselves. On the other hand, that's no longer just a nice thing to say. That's an absolute physical imperative. Our civilization will not, I think, last the rest of this century unless we get busy in building a world in which social equity, justice, and a kind of a level-headed approach to what the world has to offer comes to the fore, simply because it's all on a collision course with reality.
I'm struck because I meet a lot of people who seem individually kind and who seem to agree with you that we need to be working together and prioritizing justice. But I also witness a lot of these people not actually being able to affect the sorts of changes they would like to see when they get into institutions or systems. Do you think at an institutional level we're capable of the kind of change that we need?
Absolutely. And the answer depends on all of us. You know, a lot of times when I give lectures, people say, well, you're just preaching to the choir. Everybody knows all of that. And mm-hmm. I say, well, they do preach to the choir. The reason they preach to the choir is so they'll get off their dead behinds and get up and do something. Mm-hmm. You know, it's fine to be the choir. It's all very good to say it's good to do good things. But on the other hand, we have an absolute necessity for the survival of civilization. And if people can get that through their heads, if universities could, by expanding the moral, environmental, philosophical education to understand different cultures around the world, to be more international, to understand our responsibility, and really for all graduates to grasp the kinds of important environmental factors that are affecting our lives, then I think there's good hope. No better place than a university, no better place than a church, no better place than in our own homes.
I want to follow up on this point about cultural understanding, because you've mentioned it in your writings as well, and I agree that cultural understanding is really important, but I think I need some convincing on the point that just having colleagues who are international or knowing other students from other places or even spending a semester studying other places is really what we need to solve this problem. It's so immense. But do you believe that? So convince me.
It's a lot better than not doing it.
That's true.
I mean, that's the way I would start.
That's true.
The Peace Corps was a brilliant idea by President Kennedy, and the reason was people went and lived with other people. Ramanathan, a great climate scientist at Scripps Institution in California, lived in poor villages in India for 6 months so that he could understand what the people were really up to. It's fine to say the words, but if you've experienced it, and if you've seen people living in poverty, and if you've seen women totally suppressed and children, if you've been in a place and seen that only the male children are really well taken care of, which is all too common in the world, then your heart will really be moved and you really start to do something. Effectively, for outreach, there are a number of things you can do. You can either go and live in another country and devote yourself to it, which is something relatively few people may do. But the United States, with its multiracial, multireligious diversity, is actually, regardless of what we do, uniquely positioned to do. You can affect your government's policy, you know, not in a trivial way, but in a fundamental way. You know, I always think, I worked a lot in China and I work a lot in India, and I always think, we have some understanding of China. We've been associated with China kind of historically since the middle of the 19th century. It's very different from what we are, but we have gained some kind of an appreciation of it, some kind of an appreciation for Chinese art, some kind of appreciation for Chinese culture and sometimes Chinese values. By the way, when I once met Amy Tan, I said I learned more about how to behave in China from your books than I did from being there so many weeks and months. She's a very keen observer. I mean, even though she grew up in San Jose, California, she's a very keen observer. You can learn a lot and you can practice a lot. From a political perspective, you can convince other people to do things about it. And on the other hand, if you look at India, America pays virtually no attention to India except on the end of a phone answering service. If you think of India, if you ask an American, what do you think about India, they will usually say the outcasts, the outcast classes, mystical religions, and now they might say phone answering services and computers. But, you know, India is a country of 1.2 billion people, you know, four times the size of the United States. Wouldn't it be good to know a lot more about them? And when I say know a lot, because how can we deal with them otherwise? When I say know a lot more about them, I mean know a lot more about their philosophy, their paintings, their reasons for doing what they do and all, because we're not all the same. And if we're going to build a common spaceship, if we're going to sail a common spaceship together, we better learn something about one another.
I agree.
So that when you say, step up to the wheel, Scotty, or something, Scotty will know what you mean.
I like that metaphor. So we're all in this spaceship together, and it seems like we need to be working together, else we're all going to crash. Do you think most people grasp that?
No. Do you?
No. back. Sometimes I think we're all going to die. Well, we are, but I think we're all going to die prematurely.
You don't really know that.
That's true. But I want to take it in a sort of different direction. You're quite candid, and as a scientist, this strikes me as sort of odd. Where do you get your motivation to speak so strongly about ethical responsibilities of science or these issues?
I guess I've been around the world a lot, and I can see it. And I also work in a field, sort of broadly speaking, population biology, ecology, and evolution, where the principles of what I'm talking about are perfectly obvious, as they are to colleagues like Paul Ehrlich and Ed Wilson and Tom Lovejoy and so forth. Mm. And I'm a person who believes that civilization exists only because people communicate with one another, that we learn from one another. And I'm very satisfied with the traditional Jewish view that the reason you go on is because your ideas go on. So to me, it's an imperative to actually communicate your ideas to other people. If you do, you are immortal because you will always be remembered for having done good things and for having given ideas and so forth, and that's passed on. The form of what you are matters far less to me. And given that kind of feeling, and also being mostly of Irish heritage and really liking to talk, it's natural for me to want to encourage other people to pay attention to these things. And I think if you're a scientist, you know it's also absolutely necessary. You can choose to withdraw inside your shell and sit in a comfortable home and just soak up whatever good things there are. And there's something very appealing about that. But on the other hand, if you turn that around, if you have the privilege of doing that, then you also have an obligation to use the kind of privileged status you have in the world so that you're not a poor girl in the back streets of a poor town in Kazakhstan or something. You can actually make a difference in the world. And to me, that conveys obligation. Maybe it was because I was brought up with an Irish Catholic heritage that I got off to a start in that direction, but to me it's the only way to be.
Hmm. So do you think, so you said you grew up as Irish Catholic, do you still identify as Catholic?
Well, I think I don't, I'm not observant anymore, but I feel that I'm still very much in the mold, in the ethical mold that I was taught was correct when I was a kid. And I think, you know, you say a person is Jewish, they always say, but I don't go to synagogue anymore, but they're still Jewish. They still have many of the values that they had when they grew up. Now, being Jewish is a very enveloping cultural life if you practice it to the full. And in fact, Judaism, like being Latter-day Saint or something, is something that you really can only practice well if you're in a group. But I feel permanently identified in that. I mean, I never heard of prejudice against different groups of people until I was in college. I mean, I just accepted the fact that we're all in it together.
I grew up Catholic as well, and I think some of my ethical practice comes from Catholicism. But I'm wondering, for people who aren't religious at all or who may not have had that training, where do you think the moral imperative to care for the environment comes from?
I think everybody knows that we have to care for one another. I think you get that. That's a natural. That's more like the kind of principle that made it possible to found religions in the first place, because we have a number of feelings in ourselves about what we ought to do. Mm-hmm. We came to believe, as our numbers grew and as we lived more together, we came to believe in principles like are embodied in the Ten Commandments or in the Golden Rule or what have you. Those are ways of living together with one another. And I think pretty much everybody has inside those basic principles about not stealing, not killing people, not speaking badly of people, and all the rest. And I think you can build on those. I think religions have been elegant and at times extremely effective ways of getting people to understand and think about those principles. But I think the principles are even prior. I think they're there for all of us and always will be.
Can I ask you a personal question?
Yeah.
Do you believe in God?
only in a, I believe in God in a very general sense, sort of like Gaia. I believe that there are principles, there are things in the world that, there are things in the universe that can only be explained beyond the facts that we know. You couldn't have had a Big Bang, you couldn't have had the evolution of the universe, you couldn't have had the evolution of our solar system and all, if there were not enormous guiding principles in the world. And in the sense of there being enormous guiding principles that I want to understand and follow and observe, I think the answer would, to me, the answer would be yes. If you personify God, then I think it's unreasonable. But I think I think our universe has meaning, whether we can grasp it or not.
I'm trying to think what my last question is, because I'm aware that I have just one. I guess if you could make that meaning into a story, the meaning of the universe, what would the story be?
Oh, well, you have two people here who've done that very beautifully.
That's true. We're in the right class.
I think they've got the right answer.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well then let me change my question.
And I think that's very much what I just said, really.
That's true. Then let me change my question. So you said that ideas are really important, or one of the most important things that live on beyond us. What's one idea that you would like to live? One, if you had to choose just one that lived beyond you, what would it be?
I think always to be kind to other people and listen to what they're saying. Delight in them. I think that really makes it all worthwhile.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Raven, this has been an incredibly insightful and inspiring conversation. We really appreciate your honesty and your compassion for others. On behalf of Amma and myself and the entire class, we're really grateful to you for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.